Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info.
Today, we begin a series of reports that will discuss the latest scientific papers on the European Space Agency's Rosetta mission to Comet 67P. In addition to countless unresolved puzzles facing comet scientists, we have discussed in previous episodes the problem of the comet's double-lobed shape. However, that particular form of a comet nucleus is apparently not unique. Several other of the comets imaged to date have displayed similar forms. Multiple asteroids, including this one imaged on July 25th of this year, have displayed distinct peanut-like shapes, with a marked narrowing at the body's neck. And recently, NASA's New Horizons mission has revealed that the Plutonian moon Hydra also has a double-lobed form. Why do so many of these different types of bodies in the solar system display this particular shape? The Electric Universe theory states that comets and asteroids were electrically excavated from planets and moons in a relatively recent epoch of planetary instability. As discussed in previous episodes, plasma scientist Dr. C.J. Ransom produced these familiar double-lobed forms in experiments with electrical discharges to samples of hematite. In fact, Comet 67P has revealed countless distinctly planetary features, including wind-streaked rocks, fields of boulders and rubble, mountainous terrain that appears to have been uplifted from a planetary body, and even sand dunes. However, as Wal Thornhill explains, the only explanation that Rosetta scientists can offer for the comet's shape is a remarkably improbable low-velocity collision between two comets.
A report by the European Space Agency published on 28th September titled How Rosetta's Comet Got Its Shape concluded from some important research published in the journal Nature the same day that two comets collided at low speed in the early solar system to give rise to the distinctive rubber duck shape of Comet 67P Churyumov-Gerasimenko. Earlier there were two competing ideas. Did two comets merge, or did localized erosion of a single object form the neck? Now, scientists have an unambiguous answer to the conundrum. They have shown that the shape arose from a low-speed collision between two fully-fledged, separately formed comets. Matteo Maseroni, lead author from the University of Padua, Italy, and an associate scientist of the OSIRIS team, said, "It is clear from the images that both lobes have an outer envelope of material organized in distinct layers, and we think these extend for several hundred meters below the surface. This points to the layered envelopes in the comet's head and body forming independently before the two objects merged later," concludes Matteo. "It must have been a low-speed collision in order to preserve such ordered strata to the depths our data imply." Co-author Bjorn Davidson added, "In addition, the striking structural similarities between the two lobes imply that despite their initial independent origins, they must have formed through a similar accretion process. Layering has also been observed on the surface of other comets during previous flyby missions, suggesting that they also underwent a similar formation history." Holger Sierks, OSIRIS principal investigator at the Max Planck Institute for Solar System Research in Göttingen, said, "How the comet got its curious shape has been a major question since we first saw it. Now, thanks to this detailed study, we can say with certainty that it is a contact binary." So much for the reports. But how exactly do you get two widely separated bodies experiencing similar primordial stratified accretion? And why primordial? That's simply an assumption. And the mechanism of gravitational accretion has never been shown to work. Notice also the emphasis on gentle and low-speed collisions. Just how slow does it have to be so the result is not mutual fragmentation and dispersal? And how does a collision form a neck between the two lobes? On top of that, what are the chances of collision of two tiny bodies of a few kilometers cross-section in a volume of space in the outer solar system that is unimaginably huge? The explanation requires so many post hoc and unlikely conditions that it is unbelievable. It only passes the critical faculties because it's a story that has been repeated and repeated until we no longer think about it. The Nature paper refers to the stratified rocky-like material seen on the comet's surface. It shows how experts can become blind to what the untrained eye can plainly see, that Comet 67P is rocky. The selective blindness occurs because it destroys a cherished belief in the centuries-old story of the primordial solar system. But that story has failed repeatedly. It is not predictive. Each new discovery is a surprise, the most recent being Pluto and its moon. And now that we have information from more than 2,000 exoplanetary systems, our solar system seems like the odd one out. But modern specialization and fragmentation of science allows such disconnects to exist and spread, which must lead to an inevitable crisis. The history of science shows this to be the case, with centuries of stagnation followed by sudden breakthroughs, and often the breakthroughs have come from outsiders who look at problems with a beginner's mind. Old beliefs die hard. The astronomer, the late Tom Van Flanden, in his 1993 book Dark Matter, Missing Planets and New Comets, made the comparison between comets, minor planets and asteroids and suggested they are the same basic types of rocky bodies. Comets are dark, reflecting a few percent of sunlight, which is not expected for icy bodies. And radar echoes from Comet Encke implied a non-porous, probably rock, surface material. An expert in celestial mechanics, Van Flanden is perhaps best known for his exploding planet hypothesis, which he proposed as the origin of asteroids and comets, and which he supported by showing that the orbits of comets and asteroids could be understood in terms of an origin in a late explosive event in the asteroid belt. His exploding planet hypothesis is discounted, of course, by the lack of a plausible mechanism to cause a planet to explode, and now by the onion skin layering in the two lobes of Comet 67P, which implies formation by accretion rather than fragmentation in an explosion. But his arguments are compelling for a cataclysmic event in the asteroid belt that produced tens of thousands of asteroids and comets. What's most persuasive is that his unusual hypothesis predicted stable asteroid satellites, which was surprisingly confirmed. So what was the explosive event, and how did it form peanut-shaped comets and asteroids? The chances of direct collisions of tiny rocks in the vastness of interplanetary space to produce the peanut shape are negligible. Multiply that by the odds of the colliding rocks sticking together and forming a neck, and the chances are about zero. Gravitational capture and tidal forces do not enhance the odds significantly. The serious nature of this problem was highlighted in July this year when Lance Benner, who leads NASA's asteroid radar research program, said that radar imaging has shown that about 15% of near-Earth asteroids larger than 600 feet, or 180 meters, have this sort of lobed peanut shape. There must be a process that forms the double-lobed shape naturally. A clue comes from experiments done by C.J. Ransom using an electric discharge striking hematite powder to simulate the red Martian surface. The Martian blueberries were replicated in color and shape by the laboratory discharges. It was also found that interlocking blueberries are a property of spherules formed during an electric discharge. It may also be significant, considering the apparent low density of Comet 67P, that the hematite spherules were hollow with thick walls. It seems that the catastrophic event required by Van Flanden's research was of an electrical nature. There is a cosmic electric discharge, an interplanetary thunderbolt, which has been graphically depicted many times in our space news. Van Flanden, an expert in orbital dynamics, traced his exploding planet event to the asteroid belt beyond Mars. So it is highly significant that Mars was identified with the cosmic thunderbolt and was reported to have received a scar, visible at the time from Earth, following a battle using this favored weapon of the planetary gods. The Great Canyon system of Valles Marineris, which stretches a third of the way around Mars, is that scar. Almost 4 billion cubic kilometers of rock and dust was excavated from Mars within the memory of mankind, a great deal of it accelerated into space by a gigantic plasma arc. Meteorites from Mars are still arriving on Earth today. And in 1988, I published a paper arguing that of 17 mysteries associated with common meteorites, a plasma arc process could explain all of them. The discharge attracts and heats matter along the discharge axis. Repeated lightning strokes along the same path will produce layering of matter accreted along that discharge axis. The appearance of that discharge could be likened to bead lightning, a string of glowing rocky beads. Matter is also accelerated along the axis, giving a high probability of forming lobed asteroid and comet precursors. The spatially and temporally confined nature of this process is also ideal for forming stable asteroid and comet satellites. So when Rosetta project scientist Matt Taylor says of Comet 67P, "This result adds to our growing knowledge of the comet, how it formed and its evolution," he is dead wrong. The accepted story of the slow formation and evolution of the solar system over billions of years is fictional. The story I have told here is one of chaos and violence in the solar system within the last 10,000 years or so. As one philosopher has written, Newton, on consciously religious rather than scientific grounds, gave currency to a new form of the old belief that the celestial order is altogether superior to the terrestrial and cannot, in particular, be the scene of any catastrophic change. That belief has not changed much in 350 years. When researchers are met with endless surprises in space exploration, they must be open to re-examining old beliefs and assumptions. Only then will mankind benefit fully from their remarkable space engineering and exploration feats.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.